This is what we're going to be looking at in CompTIA Server Plus.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this course, CompTIA Server Plus exam, will certify the successful candidate has knowledge and skills. What they've added onto the Server Plus, they used to have a course for storage.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a separate course. So they've added on the storage part onto the Server Plus, and they've added on some virtualization. If you haven't worked with virtualization, you will find out about virtualization in this course.
Okay.
So you'll have a required to install, configure, manage server, hardware operating systems by implementing proper security controls, and successful troubleshooting common server problems, and demonstrating an understanding of key disaster recovery concepts. What happens when your server goes down? You're probably not in charge of the servers, are you?
I will be in charge of the servers.
Okay, so you're going to be... You're taking this course to know about servers?
I just need a certification in order to be a server administrator. Just to sort of like, hey, she knows about servers pretty much. And then you just learn on the job pretty much.
Trial and error.
Yep.
Break and repair.
That's the one.
That's how I learned. I did Novell servers. I don't think you probably remember them. I don't know if you do.
Oh, no.
Novell was before the main server in the world. This was before Microsoft came out with their servers.
Oh, okay.
Back in 94. So I studied Novell servers and stuff. And Microsoft made the client to connect to the servers, and Novell made the servers. Very, very good servers. I used to love them because there was servers. You wouldn't reboot them for a year or 2 years.
Wow.
You know, and there was a case, I don't know if it was true or not, but they couldn't connect to the server in this office, and they didn't have an IT person there. So they called Novell, and they told him, hey, we need somebody to come and fix our server. We can't connect to it. So they said, sure. So they sent somebody over there, and he went looking around. Can you tell me where the server is? He goes, oh yeah, follow me. And they kept walking around, walked around the whole building and everything. And they couldn't find the server.
Wow.
They couldn't find the server. So they finally decided to follow the back then it was, they had a wire communication, you know. So they didn't have wireless. So they followed the wires. Turns out they had built around the server, and they left it locked in.
Oh, wow.
So there was no door to the server room, so they had to break down the wall. But that server had been up for like 2 or 3 years.
Oh, I think he sent me the...
Okay, so this is the course objectives. Understanding physical hardware installation is one of the most important things to know. When you're buying servers, you got to make sure what the requirements are. When you know what the requirements are, then you can dictate what hardware you need. Like, you remember the question that asked you, what does a server need to virtualize? Mm-hmm. Well, you need a processor that will enable or will let you virtualize. Not all processors do. Most of them nowadays will, because virtualization is so common now.
Yeah.
So you deploy, manage, and maintain storage and hardware. Now with the servers in Windows, you can actually turn it into, are you familiar with SANs and NASs?
I'm familiar with them. I just haven't worked with them.
Okay. Well, it's just a group of servers, a group of hard drives
that
are distributed on the wire, and they act as they share them to servers that don't have enough space.
Mm-hmm.
And there's two ways of sharing them. One is with the SAN, which is what they call blocked. I'll explain that to you later on. And the other one is called a NAS, network attached server, and it shares it like a file share.
Awesome. You
know, and it'll assign it to and gives it permissions. So you can create a server to do that now, you know, instead of buying a NAS or a SAN because they're more expensive. If you have the room for them, if you have enough space on them. We can install server operating systems, configure and maintain server functions, including high availability. High availability is what you want when you want a continuous business. You want your business continuity, they call it.
Gotcha.
You don't want your business to go down. Like, let's say you're at a Sam's, right? Mm-hmm. You're at a Sam's, it's on a Sunday, it's a busy Sunday, it's a long lines, you know? And then all of a sudden the servers go down and nobody can charge in the point of sales. So all people are just waiting there in line to pay. You know, more than 40 or 50% of the people will leave. And you just lost sales. You know, so you want high availability, you know, a way of being able, if one server goes down, another one comes up.
Gotcha.
Okay. Summarize the purpose and operation of virtualization, why we use virtualization, how we use it, and explain the importance of asset management. Asset management is knowing what you have in your network, all the assets you have, counting endpoints, clients, APs, access points, switches, routers, servers, cables, UPSs, everything. All those are assets for your company. You want to document and you want to make sure that you have the licensing, the appropriate licensing for all of the software that you're using and for all the operating systems that you're using.
Mm-hmm.
So you will learn about licensing concepts, summarize the basics of scripting for server administration. When you do repetitive tasks, it's easier to create a script. Script is a set of commands that will repeat by themselves. Instead of you typing them in 50 times, you just create the script, a set of commands, and you run that script and it'll do it for you, you know, like maybe on a monthly basis, weekly basis, mm-hmm. daily basis, or whatever the need may be. So scripting helps the administrator do its job in an automated fashion. Automation is key. Automation is key because once you start automating, you remove the weakest link. Who's the weakest link? Any idea?
Say it again.
Yeah. For that matter, in life itself, who makes the more mistakes?
I think it's my computer. My computer keeps cutting in and out while as you're talking.
Okay. Who makes more mistakes?
People that are less experienced.
People. Humans are the weakest link. So when you automate something, once you get the automation right, it might take you, you know, a month to get the script running the way you want it to run. Then you just run the script. And you have no more automation. I mean, you know, you have no more human intervention. Okay?
Gotcha.
All right, so we're going to summarize data security. How do we secure the data? There are various forms and different categories on securing. You want to do least privilege always. and have physical security concepts, you know, who can go in and out of the server room, how, you know, not just letting anybody, hey, can I see your server room, and let them in. Understand identity and access management, which is IAM for short, for server administration. This means that who you're giving permissions to, who you're creating accounts for, what type of permissions you're giving them, and how you account for the whatever they do on the server or the resource that they're using. Application for server hardening methods. Hardening means making it harder for, excuse the redundancy, but it's making the server, fertilizing the server so that it's not easily attacked. How do I do that? By shutting down services that I don't need. Mm-hmm. And they can be, can you hold on a second? Rohit is calling me.
Yeah.
Yes, Rohit. Hi. Yes, but I'm talking about the student. It's for the student. Okay. All right. Then, all right. I thought she got one and I got one. And okay, I'll share the book with her. Okay. Well, she doesn't have a manual. The student does not have a manual. Training material. I do. Yes, I do. Okay, you want me to share that? Okay, I just need another lab. Okay. Yeah, that's it. Uh-huh. All right. Okay. Bye. Got that fixed. Apparently, the lab that they sent me was supposed to be for you.
Oh, the one where I can't get into it.
Huh?
Yeah, David sent me an email with the key and it's saying it's already been redeemed.
Yeah, that's the one that I redeemed.
Yeah.
Because you're supposed to get one. I'm supposed to get one.
Gotcha.
Okay. But they just gave me one. They're going to share another one.
Okay.
So I should have waited to find out, you know. So let me see here. Let me share the. Let's finish up this one and then I'll share the manual with you.
Okay.
Application of server hardening. Explain data security risk and mitigation strategies. Explain the importance of disaster recovery, backups and restores. Summarize server decommissioning concepts. When a server is no longer wanted or no longer using, mm-hmm. How do you decommission it? And troubleshoot common hardware and storage problems. Troubleshoot common software and operating system problems. So the course layout will have lessons, topics, job tasks, exam objective mappings. The exam objective mappings means that CompTIA has a exam objectives. Right. Mm-hmm. So the exam objectives are they come throughout the course. They don't come in order. They come, you might see the last exam objectives first and then they come all in different ways. So it would be a good idea. Do you have the lab exam objectives?
I think I do, but I have it from CompTIA from when I took it the last time.
Okay. So we have Cert Master Learn and Cert Master Learning Center to get strength, weaknesses, dashboard, lessons, study guide. This is where the performance-based questions are.
Gotcha.
Practice and assessments, and they have flashcards. They're pretty good, but I don't really spend too much time on those.
Mm-hmm.
So the first day, we should see understanding server administration concepts, understanding virtualization and cloud computing, and understanding physical and network security concepts. Now, I gave you my 2 cents worth of servers. Now, let's see what CompTIA says.
Okay.
So this topic is going to provide background information about the role of a server administrators and does not cover specific exam objective. So it's just an overview. Okay. Common sysadmin responsibilities. You're a system administrator, so you're going to have different roles. You know, you might be the one creating the users, building the servers, and maintaining them, updating them, making sure they're working, they're not overworking. So these are common sysadmin responsibilities. I don't know if that's what you're going to be doing. Installing, configuring, managing hardware apps, network components, managing the lifecycle, monitoring its performance, capacity planning, access control, troubleshooting, liaising with other IT teams, resolving escalated support tickets, managing disparate technologies and network services, providing documentation and improving communication and presentation skills, advising on and implementing security policies. So servers versus workstations. Now, workstation characteristics normally assigned to an end user.
Okay.
There is no redundant hardware. Sometimes it depends. If it's a high performance workstation, you might have redundant hardware. Have you heard of RAID? You remember RAID in security?
Yeah, RAID 1056, yeah.
Okay, so you might have a high-performance workstation that's maybe running CAD or something, mm-hmm. and they might have a redundant array of, a RAID system.
Okay.
But it says that normally a workstation is just for email, doing their job, going out to the internet, and Word, Excel, and stuff like that. So they don't need a high performance hardware. Okay. They really don't, unless it's a high performance profile workstation. So the client OS is optimized for a single user. Normally, in a network, in an environment for an organization, you want to get an operating system that will support the domain. If you get a home, you know, the different licenses for operating systems on workstations, Windows 10 has home, it has professional, I think it has enterprise, and it has education.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if you buy a home for a company, guess what? You won't be able to connect to the domain. So if you're the procurement officer or the procurement mm-hmm. manager, and you tell them, hey, I got a great deal on all these servers, you know, they're all home editions, and I got them real cheap. Really? Well, guess what? We can't use them.
Yeah.
Because I can't connect a home office license I cannot use on a domain server. So you have to watch out for that. People, sometimes when I'm giving classes, they're using home editions, and I tell them to do something on the machine, and they can't do it because they have home edition, and it's very limited. It's for home. Yeah. You know, it's for kids. Okay. So we have a client OS optimized for single user, apps optimized for single users, elegant GUI, desktop and laptop form factor. Form factor means the size and the form of the computer. Form factor means it's a big, tall desktop, or it's a small mini desktop, or it's a medium sized desktop. It's a laptop. It's a notebook. It's just the size and the form that takes on that computer. That's what they call form factor. Okay. So you can have desktops, which I rarely see now, in the office, or you can have laptops. Okay. Now a server is secured in a server room. Okay. Why? Because it serves all the workstations. It has redundant hardware. It has high performance hardware. It has server OS optimized. Now, there is a difference between the client system operating system, or the operating system, and the server operating system. The server operating system is called a network operating system. In other words, a NOS. Okay, if you're writing down notes, it's called a NOS. It's optimized for many users. Apps optimized for multiple users, limited or no GUI. They can have a GUI. They can be just command line based. They can be a domain controller read only, where I can't add users to it. I can only copy the users from other domain controllers, because all domain controllers synchronize their database. Okay, they can be rack mounted, where they go on a rack, or they can be on the floor, you know, just like a box. Nowadays, they're more rack mounted, and they're not even that, they're more virtualized. Now, workstation operating systems, we have Microsoft Windows 10, we have Ubuntu Desktop Linux, we have Mac OS's. And server operating systems, we've got Microsoft Windows Server 2019, Red Hat Enterprise Linux. Red Hat is another server for, it's a big, it's very well known, but it's for Linux. Do you know anything about Linux?
Yeah, I know about Linux. I actually got to play in Linux the other day, trying to build out some databases.
All right. So workstations versus servers versus workstation and server security. So the server lifecycle, well, we procure it, we buy it, right? We use it, and then it comes to its end of life. Like a 2003 already came to its end of life a while back ago. Mm-hmm. 2003, we have, what else do we have? 2008 already came to its end of life. And I think 2012 is already at end of life. So we need to recycle or dispose of the hardware. And to be able to dispose of the hardware, we need to make sure that all the information on the server is wiped clean or is backed up. Okay, before we disable it, you know, we can shred the hard drive. You know, once we back it up, we can shred the hard drive. We can even incinerate it. But if we're going to repurpose the server, not as a server, but maybe, I don't know, maybe a print server that manages printers, we can do that. And it's not a high-end server anymore. But it is a server that can still work for a couple of more years for something in the background. So if we repurpose it and we use the same hard drives that were on there, we need to make sure that there is no information on it. Okay. So this is a server life cycle: procurement, usage, end of life, disposal, and recycling. People used to throw away the servers in containers, you know, in the back of the in the back of the, what's it called? In the back of the building. They go to the container and they throw it in there. Okay, so the four major subsystems. The subsystems are anything that can give you a bottleneck. Think of it that way. So a processor can give you a bottleneck if it goes above 90% for more than 5 or 10 minutes. Okay, it's stuck on a process and it's not doing any more processing. Memory, you can run out of memory. Storage, you can run out of storage. The network might be saturated. It's also a bottleneck. So these are the four subsystems: processor, memory, storage, and network. And each one of these subsystems have sub-counters. Okay, they have sub-counters so you can monitor, you know, how they're doing. We have Linux OSs, Linux and Windows. Linux is Red Hat Linux derivatives, Red Hat Enterprise Linux. We have Fedora, we have CentOS, Debian Linux derivatives have Debian Linux, Ubuntu, Kali. Kali is a ethical hacking distribution, mm-hmm. And we have Windows servers. So review server administration and concepts. Understanding troubleshooting methods. Explain the troubleshooting theory and methodology. Now, CompTIA has a troubleshooting theory and a methodology of how you're supposed to go about fixing a problem on a server, client, or whatever problem there is. It says to follow certain steps, okay? So if you follow these steps, you know, you will most likely get them to work. Okay?
Okay.
All right. So we're talking about the troubleshooting methodology that CompTIA likes to, they have a troubleshooting methodology for each one of their certifications. They all look the same, but they change very, very little. The first thing is to identify the problem. Okay, you need to identify what's going on. They can't connect to the internet. They can't print. They can't log in. They can't get to their resources. They can't get to a shared folder. Identify the problem. You determine the scope. You know, how much is it? Is it only them? Is it more than one person? Is it how much is it affecting it? You establish a theory of probable cause or question the obvious, you know, hey, are you connected? You know, is your wire connected? Is your computer turned on? Is the switch on? You know, did they have any changes last night? You know, was anything changed last night that could have caused this to? Test the theory to determine the cause and you establish the action plan. Okay, you'll be asked about this and they'll tell you you're establishing an action plan. What did you do before that? Well, I tested the theory. What do you do after that? Well, I implement a solution or I escalate. There's a time when you know that, you know what, this is above my head. I don't know what's going on. I can't help you. Let me escalate this. Okay. It's kind of being humble and knowing that you can't do it. You verify full system functionality if the implementation works. Make sure that everything else is also working, that you didn't break something when you implemented the solution.
Mm-hmm.
So you implement preventive measures, you know, like tell them, don't be going into this website, don't do this, don't do that, or take off some ports that has open. Okay. You perform a root cause analysis, you know, what caused it, what caused this problem, how did it begin, did he install the software? That's why people should have least privilege so they can't install whatever they want on their computer, because a computer is a company's computer, it's not theirs, you know, and people, you know, tend to use it as if it was their own computer. You document findings and actions and what your outcomes were. Okay, that's the whole troubleshooting methodology. When you identify the problem and determine the scope, you're trying to find out what the problem is and how how big the problem is, you know, how much is it affecting the user? And if it's only that user or more users in his, you know, next to him. When you establish the theory of probable cause, you question the obvious. You know, ask the user if he's installed anything in the day before or earlier. Most likely, the user is going to say, "No, this was like this when I got here." Mm-hmm. You know, they're not, and they don't like to admit that they did something wrong. Mm-hmm. So they're going to tell you that. So hopefully, you'll get a true user. You know, some users I've gotten that they take them home and they let their kids use their laptop and the kids start downloading stuff. Then I find a software. I go, "What about this software?" "Oh yeah, I forgot all about it. I took my laptop home last night. My kid was using it. He probably did it." No. Okay, so you test your theory to determine the cause. You establish a plan of action. What are you going to do? Don't say you're going to format the hard drive, because that's not the best way to fix it. A lot of people think that that's the only way to fix it and the quickest way to fix anything. You know, try rebooting. That would be one thing, but not formatting. And try to be courteous to the client. You might get all kinds of clients, you know, you probably won't, but this is not like PC tech. This would be on the server. So yeah. You be trying to find out what's going on. Have any changes? Did anybody change anything? You know, because there's going to be more than one server administrator. How big is the company you work for?
We support the Army, so a lot of people.
What?
Yes, we support some units under some commands. So a lot of people that we support a lot of people on Fort Bragg.
All right. So you're in the Army?
No, I used to be in the Army. I'm a contractor now.
Okay. So you don't have to follow everybody's order?
That's correct.
Was that a pain?
It definitely was. Now it's different because I'm my own person. I just go to work and I go home and no one's calling my phone after I leave at 4:00.
That's good. Better pay, I guess.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, definitely.
Okay. So implement the solution or escalate it. You know, if you know that you can't do it, you know, don't try and trick the person. And I can do it. I can do it. I can do it. You know, I've gotten into a lot of problems trying to do that until I just came to a realization that, hey, you know what? I went to school in University of San Francisco and I had this real good instructor. And he told all of us in the group, he said, "Look, if you guys are in IT, there's two things you got to live by. Two rules. One, you don't know everything. Mm-hmm. You do not know everything. Impossible for you to know everything in IT. Second one is you have to admit that you don't know everything." Mm-hmm. Okay, so live by those two rules and you'll be fine. So I used to go and I was a consultant in San Jose, Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. And I would go to fix the servers, you know, and the owner or the IT manager would tell me, "Hey, Sam, how long do you think it'll take?" I go, "Just give me a couple of hours. I'll be done." It was 9:00. Then it was 8:00 at night and I was still there. And they tell me, "A couple of hours, huh, Sam?" Well, I ran into some problems. Mm-hmm. So then I came up with a little gimmick. You know, I tell them, they'd ask me, "How long is it going to take?" I said, "About 2 weeks." "What? 2 weeks? What do you mean 2 weeks?" I go, yeah, I got to check the whole server and everything. 2 weeks. I go, okay, let's compromise. Give me 2 hours. And in 2 hours, I'll tell you if I can fix it or not.
Mm-hmm.
So just let me be for 2 hours. In 2 hours, I'll let you know. Okay. So come back in 2 hours, leave me alone. And then I'll tell you if I fixed it or I can't fix it or I need to escalate it or we need to buy something or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I live by that rule, you know. That way I don't spend my time trying to do something I don't know how to do. And I'm honest with the customer.
Yeah.
I don't charge them more than 2 hours. It's a 2 hour minimum. Back then it was a 2 hour minimum anyway. So when you verify the full system functionality is when you fix the problem, but you want to make sure that you didn't break another one. You didn't break something else. Okay, so once you fix the problem, you verify the full functionality of the server, you know, make sure that everything else is still working.
Mm-hmm.
And that way that you feel comfortable that everything else is working and you don't have to do a rollback. Always have a rollback plan when you're installing or patches or whatever. Have a rollback plan so that you can roll back whatever you did. So you implement preventive measures, you know, maybe you might need to change the password or something. You perform a root cause analysis, which would be what was the root cause of this problem? You know, how did it get here? You know, did I not patch it? Was it a virus? What is it? What, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And you document your findings, your actions, and your outcomes, and you should put them in a knowledge base. And write them down for future use. You might have the same problem in 6 months. And then you say, what did I do? What did I do? What did I do to fix it? You know?
Mm-hmm.
And if you have it written down somewhere, it can be an Excel sheet. It can be a Word document. It can be a database, a small database, an Access database, a small SQL database, whatever you want. But just write it down so that other people can also use it too. You know, other people in your team, or you can go back to it and say, oh, now I remember what I did. Okay. So guidelines for troubleshooting methods. Troubleshooting is a key skill for a system admin. It's a key skill for any IT person. Troubleshooting. When you want to troubleshoot, you do not want to be a firefighter. A firefighter, the only thing he does is turns off the fire. Okay. I don't know if that makes sense. Turning off the fire is not
shooting.
I'm not going down to the root cause. I'm not fixing the root cause. I'm just giving it a band-aid so he can keep working.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I used to be a very, very good firefighter. You know, because I didn't know that I was supposed to go down to the root cause analysis, you know,
mm-hmm. and find,
you know, go down to the root cause and just fix it. You know, like you have a headache, right? You have a headache and they tell you, oh, and the doctor tells you, okay, take an aspirin. But he's not telling you why you have a headache.
Yeah.
You know, maybe you're stressed, maybe this, maybe that, you know, I'm not wishing you this or anything, you know, maybe you got a tumor or something and. But he's not giving you the root cause analysis. He's just turning off the fire.
Yeah.
Okay. You do not want to be a firefighter. Okay. You want a good troubleshooting person. So troubleshooting methodology is more efficient and accurate processes. Methodology could change depending on the situation. You don't have to use all the steps. Use your common judgment, you know, use your intellectual, emotional intelligence, you know, by talking with if somebody's used it before with your coworkers and, hey, did you guys do anything? And maybe a coworker did do something and he's not going to tell you. He'll act dumb or turn around. I got to go to the restroom. I got to go do something. Oh, somebody's calling me. You know,
There's all kinds of ways. I've been doing troubleshooting for the last 20 years, you know, so
yeah,
gotten all kinds of excuses.